Great. Hello, everyone. To all the esteemed panelists, welcome. And to the audience as well, welcome. It gives me immense pleasure to be moderating this session on graduation approach, mainstreaming the most vulnerable population. I would like to first introduce the esteemed panelists quickly, and then we will go into the panel discussion. There will be three parts to it. The first part will have opening comments from each of our panelists. The second part will be questions to the panelists, specifically on the graduation approach and scaling. And then the last section will be for answering questions from the audience. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce such a an experienced visionary panel. We have Mr. Balamurugan D with us. He's an Indian administrative officer with over a decade of experience in civil services in the Indian government. He is currently the Secretary, Rural Development Department, Government of Bihar, with the additional charge of CEO of Bihar Rural Livelihoods Promotion Society, also known as Jivika. In his previous roles, he has contributed immensely in the areas of digitizing the social pension programs and community-led sanitation systems. He has spearheaded the SJY program, Satat Jivika Parjan Yojana, and its scale-up in Bihar, and is really showing, Bihar is really showing us all the pathway forward. So thank you so much, sir, for joining us. Mr. Chandrasekhar Ghosh is also with us. He has been one of foremost proponents of microfinance and microbanking in India with over 30 years of experience. Bandhan was the name of the non-profit entity that Mr. Ghosh set up in 2001 with the objective of changing the lives of underprivileged by giving them small loans and handholding them on their entrepreneurship journey. The entity transformed itself into an NBFC and then finally into a universal bank by 2015, which is one of its first. Among numerous awards that Mr. Ghosh has won, the prominent ones are Senior Ashoka Fellow, Social Entrepreneurship Award, Banker of the Year, CNN IBN Indian of the Year, brings immense experience. And he's also been the former president of Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry and also the former chairman of CII Eastern Region. It's really a pleasure, sir, to have you with us in this particular context. He brings us many, many years of implementing the graduation approach across states in India. We also have with us Shagun Sabarwal, who is the Director of Policy, Training and Communications at JPAL, South Asia. She leads JPAL's SA's engagement with government, donors and civil society organizations. She provides technical and strategic direction to partnerships, including Development Monitoring and Evaluation Office at Niti Aayog, the DOPT and the state government of Odisha, Tamil Nadu and Punjab. She's currently leading JPAL South Asia's role as a knowledge partner to the government of Bihar for the scale-up of graduation approach. We also have Jasveen Bindra. She's a technical advisor for Ultra Poor Graduation Initiative at BRAC. Provides technical guidance to governments, multilaterals, international NGOs, the design, adaptation and implementation of the graduation approach. She has in the past provided technical and strategic support to the governments of Pakistan, Malawi, Rwanda, Zambia, and the state government of Tamil Nadu, and currently leads also the projects in Tanzania and Egypt. And we also have Didi, Khatun Didi from Lohar Daga, Mite Kocha in Lohar Daga. And she will also be sharing her points of views with us on the graduation approach. Thank you again and welcome everyone to the panel. I'll quickly go as the first round for the first round of opening comments. I'll go to Shagun. Shagun, can you help us understand and help also the audience understand graduation approach and also share the evidence from Bihar and why this program delivers? Shagun?
Yeah. Hi, everyone. And thanks a lot to Nudge Foundation for organizing this event. It's really a pleasure to be here and along with all of these great speakers. So, John, to your question, I think the first thing that, you know, before I dive into the graduation approach, I think it's really important to also understand the motivation behind why this approach was, you know, came to be. And I think the most important aspect about this approach is that it is really catering to the needs of a segment of population that has very unique needs. And these needs are currently not being met by mainstream social protection programs that are being run by governments or that are being run by NGOs. And the group that I'm talking about are the poorest of the poor. They've also been defined as those who are living at less than $1.90 a day. And essentially the whole idea is that we should not look at poverty as a homogeneous category, but even within poverty, there are those who are really at the sort of the end of the spectrum. And because of this, because of the different vulnerabilities they face, they are not able to break out of the cycle of poverty. And the mainstream programs, whether those are your, you know, cash transfers programs, insurance programs, somehow or the other are not being able to meet the needs of these people. This program was pioneered in Bangladesh by BRAC, you know, many years ago. And since then, there have been many different organizations that have been implementing it. In India, Bandhan Konagar has been doing this excellent work and, you know, working in multiple states to implement this approach. And the key feature of this approach is basically that first is that you really spend a lot of time in targeting and identifying who these ultra poor households are. And the whole idea is that it is a relative thinking, right? So basically within the same, in the same local context, who are really the poorest of the poor? And a lot of effort has goes into identifying who they are. So for a lot of the other schemes, you know, you just look at administrative data or you may have some of these other broad base databases. But the whole idea of the graduation approach is that you go really at the local level, identify who these people are. And many times they're actually pretty much in the margins, like they don't have identification. They have not made it into the government records. There is no way to know, you know, who these people are. So it's very important to first target and identify them in the right way. And then this program is a time-bound program with 2 years, but you start providing a sequence set of approach to these, you know, households or participants. And the way you go about doing this is that you kind of say that we want to do everything we possibly can in these 2 years to allow them to break out of the cycle of poverty. And shift them away from these means of income that are highly variable in nature, whether, you know, they could be agricultural laborers, they don't have savings. So how do you shift them towards more sustainable employment and livelihood opportunities? So you start by doing this targeting and then you give them an asset, and even how the asset is decided is, you know, there is a lot of micro planning that goes into it. And after the asset has been decided, then you go forward, provide them a lot of hand holding and coaching support. And then you also try to kind of integrate them into the existing, say, social, you know, self-help groups and other such types of infrastructures. And JPAL has been, you know, involved in doing research around this for many, many years now. And, you know, when it first happened in Bangladesh, they were like, you know, very good, great findings. And then there was this idea where CGAP and Ford Foundation came together and said that we want to run some rigorous trials and we want to see whether this approach will also work in other contexts when it's implemented by other in other countries and other NGOs. And we found some really fantastic results and results that also last. So the latest survey, you know, that we did on the initial study that was done in Murshidabad in West Bengal, where Bandhan Konagar was our implementing partner, we find that even 8.5 years after the, you know, first end line has been finished, the program participants are continuing to do really well. They have taken, you know, advantage of a lot of opportunities that are now coming their way. So since then, you know, JPAL has been working with many different state governments to get this to be a part of their, you know, existing social protection system. And we were really, really fortunate to partner with the government of Bihar and Mr. Bala and his team when the government of Bihar announced SJY in 2018. And since then, you know, the study is still ongoing. The program is still very much, you know, happening on the ground. We have just been finding like some really good, you know, whatever surveys we've been conducting, we are seeing how a lot of these households have received the assay. They are undergoing training. They're really, you know, even in the COVID and the pandemic times, they are reporting that this enterprise are also really helping them provide that income, which if in the absence they would have, you know, we all know what would have happened, you know, because of the pandemic. So all I would like to just say here is that the graduation approach, it's really important to keep in mind that it's not a program for everyone. It is for the specific poorest of the poor. And then it is really about providing a lot of approaches, like a big push intervention that touches upon, you know, sort of many aspects and has been found to be quite effective and sustainable from the evidence overall. So I'll stop here and over to you, John.
Thank you, Shagun. Thank you so much for introducing and sharing the evidence. And it is heartening to see that even after eight and a half years, the effects, the outcomes of the program is sustaining. We would love to now hear from a Didi in Jharkhand who has gone through the program for 2 years, and she's also gone through two waves of COVID. And you mentioned that you know, the graduation approach has been able to work even in these tough circumstances. So I would like to welcome Khatun Didi from Niche Kocha Lohardaga. Didi, aap hamare saath kuch share karenge. Aapka ye program mein join karne se pehle kya kya sthiti thi, abhi kya sthiti hai, aur ab kya mehsoos kar rahe hain?
मेरा नाम अख्तरी खातून, सभी को एक नमस्ते। मेरा नाम है अख्तरी खातून, जिला लोहरदगा है, घर कोचा। और ये दादा लोग जुड़ाए हैं, उसे हम लोग को बहुत ये अच्छा है, बहुत अच्छा से रह रहे हैं। पहले तो चल जाते, दादा लोग से नहीं जुड़े थे, नहीं जुड़ाए थे, उस समय तो हम लोग बहुत काम करते थे, भट्ठा उठा भी चल जाते थे कमाने वमाने, तबीयत उबियत खराब रहता था तो भी काम करने चल जाते थे, और ईटा भी ढोते थे, ढोते ढोते गिर भी जाते थे, चोट भी लग जाता था, खाने के लिए भी नहीं मिलता था सही से। अब तो दादा लोग जब से यहाँ हम लोग को जुड़ाए हैं तब से बहुत ही अच्छा रह रहे हैं, खेती बाड़ी भी कर रहे हैं, और खेती बाड़ी का ही सॉरी, मेरा बच्चा लोग चार को, हम लोग चार को परिवार होते हैं, दो मेरा लड़कियां हैं, एक मेरा हस्बैंड है, एक हम हैं, और वही मेरा हस्बैंड से जाते हैं। पहले तो पैसा वैसा भी नहीं था तो किसी का एक दूसरे का खेत में भी लगा नहीं सकते थे, अभी तो एक दूसरे का खेत में लगाए हैं, 5 डिसमिल है, उसी में भिंडी लगा दिए हैं, टमाटर लगा दिए हैं, टमाटर भी उग रहा है, भिंडी भी उग रहा है, कुछ अगला सप्ताह से बाद से मार्केट भी जाने लगेंगे, बिक्री करेंगे, जाके जाते नहीं थे, उस सब नजर भी नहीं खुला था, पर आप मार्केट भी चल गए, और वहाँ बीज उज लेते थे, वहाँ भी तक पहुँच हो गया, जाने लगे। और बकरी मेरा है, एक तो छोटा है बकरा है, दो म्यारी है, और अच्छे से खान पियन मतलब नहीं हो रहा था सही से, इसमें नहीं जुड़े थे उस समय से, अब तो भोजन उजन भी सही होने लगा, बच्चा लोग के भी खाने के लिए तरस जाते थे, वो लोग दाल मांगते थे तो देते थे, साग खाने के लिए, देहात है तो जिधर जाते थे उधर से तोड़ उड़ के ले लाते थे, तो वो लोग भी रोने लगते थे। अब तो प्याज उज भी किए थे तो उसको कुछ बहुत सब्जी बना के उसको भी दे देते हैं तो बच्चा लोग खा लेते हैं, और अच्छे अच्छे गुजर रहा जिंदगी। पहले तो बहुत ही था, मेरा हस्बैंड भी मारपीट करता था खुद से भी, वो भी नहीं सोचता था कि चल हम काम करेंगे तभी तो मेरा परिवार लोग खाएंगे, तो मारपीट करने लगता था। मेरा घर वाला भी वहाँ का भी गरीब था, ऐसा घर में दे दिया था हमको कि जिंदगी भर ही करना ही पड़ा। अब तो ऐसा मौसम भी हो गया खुशी का दिन कि अब कोई दिक्कतें नहीं होता है, हस्बैंड भी अच्छा मानते हैं।
बहुत थैंक यू सो मच दीदी, बहुत सुन के बहुत बहुत ही अच्छा लग रहा है। एंड यहाँ तक आके हमारे साथ आपका जिंदगी का ये सफर शेयर करने के लिए बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। सर चंद्रशेखर घोष के पास जाएंगे अभी। सर वी हैव नाउ वी कैन सी दैट बोथ फ्रॉम व्हाट शगुन सेज एंड फ्रॉम द दीदी हरसेल्फ वी कैन सी दैट द प्रोग्राम वर्क्स, देयर इज एविडेंस, बट वाइड स्प्रेड अडॉप्शन हैज स्टिल बीन अ चैलेंज। यू नो बिहार इज लीडिंग द वे, अदर स्टेट्स आर नाउ लीडिंग द वे, but it is still a challenge. You've been implementing the model for years now. What do you think is the most important determinant to increasing adoption of this particular model?
Thank you, Mr. Paul, and the namaskar, Didi. You expressed your feelings on that. It's a real fact in the ground in our India. We started this program in 2006, and the cause is there. We find out bottom of the pyramid, they are not reaching to the position where they can be like to develop themselves as an entrepreneur and come out from the poverty. If you see that very quick 2 points in there, maximum these people are the beggar or they are tortured by husband, and third level of that, they lost their husband and no income source in their hand. So in that sense, this all these type of people, nobody can be come forward to help them. There is a 3 to 5% of family we find out in the rural India, this type of criteria family. So when he started on that, very challenging on that. This is not the one types of some, very multiple type of challenges. And these are the challenges always, it will be like to very good things that we can be like to overcome on that. So point is there, the 2-3 points is a very critical to implement of this program. The first on that, to identify the people who can be work of this type of people and very innovatively developed this people as an entrepreneur. And when they become an entrepreneur, and then they will become created new employment for others. So this is a very challenging job to select the staff and develop the staff skill, how they can patiently work with this the people. So this is the one challenge, and need to stop motivation, not only the skill and the technical matter on that. And the second part on that, it is also is a very normalcy in our society. This level of the people always get the lots of gift or donation like on that, and after that nobody have been checked. So when this program will introduced, so the first they will say that the you have given in this the maybe the goat or this business, why you are coming to check the weekly 2-3 times? So you, why you come to disturb? So motivate these people, it is not disturb to you, it is a help to you to not to lost your capital, and you can come as a better way on that. So this is in one kind of challenge we are face this program. And initial program, again, if I give the thank you to Shogun, she mentioned about that the Bahadampur, which is in our Murshidabad, one of the worst and very poor people living in those districts. And these districts, when I started in the beginning on that, so people created a rumor. The Bandhan is the creating the situation where they are converting the people from one religious to another religious. So then they are giving these things are free. So why they are giving the free? So free things is a very created, very big difference in this community and society. And our people day and night, they have been worked on that. I given the example on that. One day I was in there, and morning I saw that there is a cow, three cows, the two ladies are standing in front of the office and say that I would like to return back this cow which you given. So why? No, no, you will convert it me in religiously, so I cannot take it. And we are trying to convince them, but they are not agreed. And we go to this, the village, and the community leaders, we have been sit together and convinced to those community leaders, and then they have been agreed on that to take it on that. So this is the this type of challenges on that in the implementation of the program. Third implementation of the program is a funding. If you see that the there is an one of the family, this is an impact of this program. It has come as a out of poverty, like on that they are developed as a, or they are created as a new entrepreneur, and not only new entrepreneur, and the Jaipal, the research have been also find out on that they are also created new employment on that. So this is in, created the very big impact in the community level. So these the people who are not counted anyone, and they are not even get the help from any of the community people on that, but ultimately they come to this position. So for that reason, we find out that their inspiration also inspired us. But point is that this the family are total cost, we find out on that the 30,000 rupees on that, and which is this is 30,000 rupees we are spent for this one family development. It's a very good achievement, I feel on that. But who will be give this the 30,000 rupees? If you see that the India is a big country, 26 crore are the family, and the there is a 1.3 crores family as per calculation of the 5% family are this type of character. But if I go to achievement of the last more than the 10 years, that is only we are reached in the 1% of the total family. That means the 1.3 lakh 30,000. So is a huge country, is a big population, is a huge. This number of the people who are eligible to come to this the program is a graduation program, is a huge needed on that. But government should come forward on that to work with us or with other organization to scale on that and reach to more people. I'm giving the very thanks to Bihar government and Jharkhand government. They are working with us and they are supported us on that. And a couple of other organization, they are also small amount is given to support to us. And Bandhan Bank also supported to this program and reaching to this the number on that. So scale is needed. Without a scale, ultimately the ground level, whatever the objective of poverty elevation, it will not impacted in that much. So for that reason, to increase this, the number is needed for our country. Even if we go to this, the government program, which is called the 100 days employment. And 100 days, whatever the employment has given, long life, hold the life on that. I suggest on that, if the government will give the 2 years support to one family, I can ensure to that this program, after 2 years, they will not go to the government to ask this 100 days job. So that is automatically they will become as a enterprise, and they also create the new enterprise, new employment for others. So this is a very good program on that. Not only give the the smile face of this type of family member, they'll save themselves from the torture of the husband, torture of the society. No, we know that now. You already mentioned, but I mentioned one point which is introduced on that. We form a village committee to take care of that after our exit. And these people are now happily come forward on that village committee to help those people. And sometimes they have need some financial also help. They are also providing it. Only we have a need on that to create the environment in the society where these people also come forward to help on that. So I feel that it is very necessary of our country to provide this the graduation program to reach to those people, and the country will become as a poverty alleviate. And not only one part, we are all people talking about financial literacy. So these people are not in a part of the financial literacy because they are not capable to open the account in the bank. They are not able to take the loan from even microcredit organization. So even the financial literacy is a main part. Financial inclusion is a main part. These people till now will not touch by this program. I request on that the government will be focused on this, the program, to alleviate the poverty in our country. Thank you to all of you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your opening comments. And you rightly mentioned scaling up the graduation approach is important. It requires adoption on the ground, talent, and funding. I'd now go to Jasmin to ask her to share BRAC's experiences of contextualizing the graduation approach and scaling it across the world. BRAC pioneered it, has implemented it across. But there are real challenges when you listen to the conditions of the DDs, various sort of geographical conditions, agroclimatic conditions, provision of social security, etc., by the governments, funding availability. What are BRAC's experiences from contextualizing and scaling across the world?
Thank you so much for that question, John, and huge thanks to all the speakers for their fascinating insights. I'll share my screen so I can share a few slides to provide my answer, but please let me know if you're able to see it. So as you had mentioned earlier, John, we at the Ultra Poor Graduation Initiative are focused on working with governments, multilaterals, NGOs, and civil society who are interested themselves in implementing and scaling up the graduation program. And we provide them technical assistance to assess, design, and operationalize the graduation approach. So I'd like to focus on two sort of key themes, both of which you touch upon in your question. One is how BRAC thinks about adapting the graduation approach to different and unique poverty context. We don't believe that one size fits all. And the second theme I'd like to touch upon quickly is how we think about integrating the graduation approach with existing government programs rather than creating a program on top of what already exists. So the most critical way that we think about adapting the approach is using what we think of as the four pillars. So we believe that every well-designed graduation program includes interventions that touch upon each of these four pillars. Very quickly, these pillars are social protection, which includes interventions that provide immediate relief for basic needs, everything from food consumption to schooling to healthcare. The second pillar is livelihoods promotion, which includes developing income-generating activities. The third is financial inclusion, which provides access to savings and loans and formal mechanisms of financial access. And then finally, social empowerment, which promotes behavioral change and integrates the participants in the community. And all of these interventions are tied together by that very hands-on coaching element that focuses on mentorship that is provided to the participants. Now, the way we think of adapting is that while we believe that each program needs to have interventions that touch upon each of these four pillars, we don't believe that every intervention looks identical in different contexts. So let me give a quick example of just two of the contexts that we work on, Kenya and the Philippines, and how different some of these interventions look in each context. I think this example is quite critical when thinking about how to adapt and contextualize the program, even in various Indian states and regions. So starting off, when we were working with the government of Kenya, we work with a large variety of implementers and even government departments. So in Kenya, we work with the National Treasury, but the program is actually implemented by two local NGOs. On the other hand, in the Philippines, we worked with the Department of Labor and Employment, and they directly implemented the program with some NGO support. Looking at that first pillar that I discussed, which is social protection, in Kenya, this meant providing subsidized enrollment in national health insurance and then adding on a consumption or food stipend on top. On the other hand, in the Philippines, social protection meant connecting participants with existing government monthly cash transfer program as well as a monthly rice subsidy. And then thinking about the very critical pillar of livelihoods promotion, in Kenya, after we did the rigorous market assessment, we found that, you know, this was primarily a pastoral society that we were working in. So many of the most common enterprises ended up being livestock. And these were provided in some regions through a cash transfer and other regions through an in-kind transfer. On the other hand, in the Philippines, we were working in a semi-rural, almost peri-urban society. And so many of the enterprises that participants selected ended up being small businesses and petty trade. So in the interest of time, I won't focus on the other two pillars, but I'm happy to expand on them in the moderator or audience Q&A. Very quickly, the second theme that I wanted to mention is how we integrate the graduation approach with existing government programs. And the real need to do this is to ensure that these programs are cost effective and they're leveraging existing resources, that they are sustainable, so they kind of stay sustainable beyond the duration of the graduation approach. And we believe that working with governments provides the real avenue for scaling the program. So if you look at this graphic on the right, this shows the work that we did in the Philippines. The boxes in green were interventions that were already being provided by the Department of Labor and Employment. These were livelihoods interventions. In blue were in the interventions already provided by the Department of Social Welfare, primarily around the cash transfer. And in yellow were the interventions that were layered on as a part of the graduation approach. So while there was already an asset transfer that was being provided with some generalized business management training, graduation added a market assessment, which expanded the types of enterprises that were considered feasible, matched those enterprises to specific household needs, and then provided very specialized technical training based on the enterprise that the household selected. Healthcare services were already provided by the government programs, but the graduation coaches ensured that participants were linked to these programs. The cash transfer program provided these large family development sessions, which included, you know, over 100 groups of over 100, providing them social and health messages. And so graduation added on smaller group sessions for these social and health messages. There were no financial inclusion interventions at that point. So graduation added on savings and loans groups, as well as connecting participants to their local committees and local government resources. And then, like I mentioned before, all of this kind of comes together through the coaching and mentorship element, which can take place through household visits or through kind of group interactions, where all of these interventions kind of come together through the coaching that these facilitators provide. So this was just a quick snapshot about how the approach doesn't have to kind of start from scratch, but can use these existing programs and build upon them to really make sure that they're holistic. And then I'll just end with saying that the graduation initiative at BRAC has recently received some catalytic funding to really focus on working with governments and thinking about scale. And as India is one of our priority countries, we're really looking forward to expanding our work there beyond the work that we're doing in an urban program in Tamil Nadu. Thank you, and passing it back to John.
Thank you, Jasveen. Thank you so much for taking us through that example. Really brings out how graduation approach can be contextualized and adapted to existing programs. It's a very good note at this point to go to Sri Balamurugan, sir. Sir, the question to you is, clearly, as Jasveen said, you know, integrating it with government programs and scaling it through government is important, and Ghosh also related that point. What did it take for Bihar to adopt and scale this model via SJY? And how did you create a platform for convergence of multiple government initiatives? The political will, the resource requirement that would have taken would have been immense. So would really love to learn from your experience, sir, at this point.
Thank you, John, and good afternoon to everyone. Namaskar, Didi. बहुत अच्छा आपने बताई, आपका अनुभव को शेयर की. शागुन, मिस्टर चंद्रशेखर, जसवीन, ऑल ऑफ देम मेड माय जॉब वेरी इजी. यू नो व्हाट आई एम गोइंग टू से इज ऑलमोस्ट काइंड ऑफ अ रिपीटेशन, बट वील आई विल शेयर माय अवर एक्सपीरियंस इन जीविका. आई थिंक एज फार एज द स्केलिंग अप ऑफ दिस मॉडल, गवर्नमेंट हैज टू बी इन्वॉल्व्ड. When I say government, particularly in Indian context, I should say State Rural Livelihood Mission is having all the ingredients for the implementation of this program in a very, very successful way. If you see what Jasmine was mentioning about four pillars of this program, social protection, livelihoods, financial inclusion, social empowerment, all these things are already part of, you know, this livelihood program. This we have national program NRLM. Bihar is having its own program from beginning, Jivika, and also we are implementing NRLM. What you have seen is, you know, we are having more than 10 lakh SHGs. It means we have 12 million members, families are part of SHG, this community based program. But what we have seen, there are so many families, poorest of the poor, even after becoming part of SHG, cannot sustain, because the basic, as is one of the important trigger in SHG is a thrift, access to loan. They are not able to, you know, they don't have the ability to save every week. And then that is fundamental requirement. And then access to credit, when they are not having capability, and then they are not confidence. That's again, most important aspect about this program is creating confidence in the families, in the member of those families. That confidence is missing. So they are not able to sustain, and again, then they are not able to move forward. That's when this kind of program is extremely important. Even after running this program, Jivika, for 15 long years, we found there are thousands of families who are not able to become part of SHG, and then they are not able to move forward. Even, you know, those kind of families are targeted through multiple government programs. You give subsidy. There are so many programs. Why they are not able to succeed? Precisely because you don't have that coaching. Again, there's a predecessor mentioned about the coaching aspect, handholding support that was missing. That's the reason in this program, we thought after doing a pilot with the help of JPAL. So this, you know, we learned from pilot, and then we started this program. The most fundamental requirement, again, as Chandrasekhar ji mentioned, is, you know, you need to have a HR, good HR, and then you need to have this commitment regarding, you know, resources. And fortunately, in Bihar, Honorable Chief Minister gave, you know, he is having that commitment. It is, in fact, personally, he oversee this program. And again, background, I'll take a minute. When the prohibition was introduced in Bihar, and there's a specific section of people, because toddy making is one particular business. It's a traditional business which was being done by so many families, thousands of families. He said, how to, you know, when we are making through prohibition that toddy making is illegal, so you need to provide, you know, alternative mechanism. That's how with this program, but not only for those section of people, but for all ultra poor families. Initial target was given to identify 1 lakh such families. Right now, we have already identified working with more than 1,25,000 families. So the pilot was started, and then we had great support, great partners. We could able to find, again, we found good partners. World Bank supported us, JPAL, and then Co-Impact came in, and then we have Bandhan Konehar supporting us. the good partners made us possible. All these things, you know, became possible because of continuous effort. It took 3 years for us to reach this stage where I would not say we succeeded already. We could able to build in systems wherein we could able to, you know, address those challenges as mentioned by Dr. Chandrasekhar. We mentioned very important challenge. One is when we are giving, you know, something free, there will be so many people who will be demanding. And we had a major, you know, apprehension in SHG program as such, there's no subsidy at all. That's the basic concept. When you are introducing the concept, actually you have a subsidy program which are being run by government, we facilitate. But in SHG self-help group, there's no concept of individual subsidy. And that's the importance of this program. But you are, you know, introducing a subsidy concept. So how it is going to? What we did, we could able to overcome that challenge, what Mr. Chandrasekhar said, by involving, communitizing this program. The community was made to understand, and we spent a lot of time that helped also to, you know, from the identification, that's very important. Community wound it up. We have village organization above SHG. We gave this program to, you know, they wound it up. And that's how we became successful. That I helped in the identification of right beneficiaries with acceptance. That's again very important, and that VO is owning it up. And I think I have so much to say for, you know, paucity of time. I stop here and I'll be, happy to answer more questions later. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. You're absolutely right. There is so much learning that you must have generated in Bihar, and probably 1 hour isn't enough for that. We'll go into the second round of questioning, especially on the point that Bala sir now mentioned, the role of community institutions, and ask the Didi about it. But before that, I want to say we have 17 minutes left until 3:30. So we, each of us here literally will have to take 3 minutes for our second round of comments. So we'll really request you to consider that and keep that in mind. Didi, aapke paas aayenge. आप पहले समूह में थे कि नहीं, और अभी समूह में आप जुड़े हैं तो उससे क्या फायदा मिल रहा है, और आपका क्या सोच है? बाकी जो दीदी हैं आपके गांव में और टोला में, उनको भी ये प्रोग्राम मदद कर सकता है, नहीं कर सकता है? आपका इसमें क्या सोच है?
पहले तो हम समूह में नहीं जुड़े थे, हमको मालूम भी नहीं था, पर दादा लोग जब ही काम में हमको सुविधा मिला तो दादा लोग गए गांव, तो वही बताने लगा कि समूह में जुड़ो, बहुत परेशानियां होगा, मतलब दुख मुसीबत में पैसा नहीं रहेगा हाथ में तो वहां से ले लेगी। हम लोग तो देबे करते हैं खेती बाड़ी करने के लिए, पर थोड़ा बहुत पैसा वहां से मिल जाएगा, 10 रुपया तो आ ही जाएगा हाथ में सप्ताह में। तो ही हम लोग समूह में जुड़े हैं, तो मेरा समूह का नाम है, दादा लोग जुड़ा है तो मेरा समूह का नाम है गुलाब महिला मंडल, और 10 रुपया हम लोग बचत करते हैं सप्ताह में, बुध दिन बैठते हैं, और वहां से समूह में जुड़े थे हम लोग का बहुत फायदा हुआ। दादा दिमाग दिया, हम लोग को उतना दिमाग भी नहीं था कि जुड़ने से क्या होगा सब, दादा लोग बोले तो। वही समय में तबीयत खराब हो गया था मेरा बहुत जोर, तो पैसा नहीं था, 1 रुपया हाथ में पैसा भी नहीं था, तो कुछ बहुत जमा किए थे हम लोग पैसा, और समूह में जोड़ने के बाद 10,000-20,000 आता है, वो वाला पैसा भी आया था, तो हम 5,000 वहां से निकाल लिए थे, उसी से मेरा नाश पानी भी नहीं था, तो वो सब भी हम किए और मेरा दुख मुसीबत भी हट गया। तो समूह में जोड़ने से हमको बहुत फायदा हुआ, और एक दूसरे को भी हमको जुड़ाना है समूह में, और बहुत दीदी लोग नहीं जुड़े हैं, और उन लोग का भी परेशानियां बहुत ज्यादा है, और उन लोग को भी परेशानियां ज्यादा है, और उन लोग को भी आगे हम लोग को भी, उन लोग को रोटी रोटी के लिए तरस जा रहे हैं, उन लोग को भी हम लोग को देखना है, पर हम लोग तो किसी तरह जी खा जा रहे हैं, तो उन लोग तरसेंगे तो फिर हम लोग बढ़ नहीं पाएंगे, सब खींच लेंगे वही लोग, करेंगे बढ़ने का, उन लोग को भी तो मुंह माया लग जाता है, उन लोग को भी आगे बढ़ाइए।
बहुत बहुत अच्छा लग रहा है दीदी सुन के, कि दूसरे दीदी के बारे में भी सोच रहे हैं। And this goes back to Balasar's opinion of how the village organizations, the community institutions have to own the program up. Mr. Ghosh, main aapke paas aaunga. Clearly, strong community institutions, village level organizations, CLFs is important. And you also touched upon the point of talent. But when we scale through the SRLMs, there is also a big, big responsibility to build the capacity of the community institutions and the cadre that will eventually handle the DD. In your experience in Bihar of working through the community institutions, what are your key learnings, if you can shortly tell us, in making this program a success? Sir, you're on mute.
Sorry. The Bihar government have been given a very good opportunities on that to involve the community, because when any NGO is coming forward to work on that, many of the question raised many times on that. When the government come forward and working with the NGO, that time many of the question will be automatically solved. So Bihar government and Jivika program have been helped on that to make this understanding in the ground level. This is a government program with the Bandhan are implementing on that. So automatically community involvement and lots of curiosity will be like to solve on that issue. This is the one part on that. Second part of that, this is challenge part, is there involve the community people is a very big challenge. Challenge means this, the people will be select who are can become on that. Those are not politically involved. And sometimes when you form this committee, the political people will first come on that. They will do. And there is a big fight will come on that. So how independently select the people who have the mind also in the social improvement. So that is a one kind of challenge. Overcoming these challenges, there is a one things we are introduced on that. There is a training conducted for the community committee. That committee peoples, we are conducted the training, what they can do, what they cannot do, and how they can be like to involve on that. And when our people is going to the field on that, the village, the monthly we conduct a one meeting with the committee along with the beneficiaries. And beneficiaries will express their improvement or their challenges or their something is further needed in front of the committee people, and our people is a catalyst. Automatically their people are understanding has come very very good way, and they also participate, they also some suggestion is given which is locally is possible to do, and sometimes they are also come forward to do something on behalf of these people. So this is the way it is happening on that. If I give the one example on that, there is one beneficiaries of the family have the child have the disease, some problem is there. No, in that time, this is the community, this committee people are come forward to send them to the hospital or the government, maximum time is a government hospital, and given that the help on that, no, they are very poor in our society, so just to give this the help on that. That is the way school benefit, hospital benefit. Other than this, I saw that some of the areas, there is an housing program for the government. And this housing program, and they are selected of these beneficiaries as a list of to submit it to the government. You can give this the support to these beneficiaries, and they are getting that benefit. So in that sense, the with the government, and some of the benefit are assigned for this the villagers in this type of family. So this committee are make a very good role how these people will get that benefit, and not only this house, many of the things on that is coming. So I hope that the empowered of this the committee is a very challenging for us to develop them, but when we involved with them and they are developed, there are more on that. I give you the one the example on that. I am one day visited in the village on that, and along with me the village committee people also working with me, and I asked them that what you see that the change of this family. I said that's a fantastic change has come this family, and he finally told me that sir, you are not to change this family, you are changed to me also. I said what I do for you. Well, sir, earlier I also take a wine in the village. Because you are given this charge to me in front of these people, I cannot take the wine. I now have been removed. The wine is not touching last couple of months. So this is my change which has come. So this is a different way we can be analysis on that. So these are the big role playing in this the program by this committee. And selection of the committee, develop the committee, and involve the committee to this the program is a very big job, but it is a possible. That is what I said.
Got it. No, thank you, sir. That's really eye-opening. The role of community institutions, empowered committees to provide social benefits to its own community. And clearly comes out through the examples that you shared. I will now go to Jasveen, clearly, you know, one of the points that has come up repeatedly is targeting the ultra poor, and many, many challenges with that. But it is also important to define what ultra poverty means, because it is a targeted program, and to be able to effectively contextualize. So coming back to you on the same question of contextualization, in the context of India's own diversity, what are your learnings, and how do we then look at the role of community institutions in that, if you're able to address that question?
Yeah, thanks, John, for that question. I think a key point that Shagun mentioned earlier in her opening remarks was that poverty is completely multidimensional, and so you can't use the same indicators of poverty that you found in one place and just supplant them to another place. So similarly, the countries we worked in, we have to do an assessment of what poverty means in that particular country. And in India, I think I definitely say that not just in a country, but in each state or in each region, you need to figure out what does it mean within that particular socioeconomic culture. So for example, it could mean food insecurity in some places, complete disconnection from social protection services, mainstream services, geographically isolated or remote communities. But it could also mean that communities are socially isolated or marginalized, that there is no market infrastructure in place. So I wish there was a simpler answer to this, but I think the complicated answer is that you have to do an assessment for what poverty means in one particular area. I think only after you've figured out who you're targeting or who are the extreme poor in that particular area, can you then contextualize the program, which is the kind of second part of your question. And some of the questions that we ask when we are doing assessments and working with local stakeholders and local staff to figure out how to design a program for what poverty looks like in that area is whether any healthcare services or education services exist in that area, or to what extent they exist. What are the government schemes that are available there, not just on paper, but the ones that actually reach people regularly? What is the market infrastructure there? What we do a market assessment to figure out what enterprises might be feasible there, because enterprises that are feasible in Bihar might not be the enterprises that are feasible in Rajasthan. So what are the, you know, critical life skills or social health messages that would need to be provided in one area? In some places, you really focus on maternal health care, for instance. In others, you focus on things like sexual harassment or gender issues, household bargaining power, alcohol abuse. So your kind of life skills curriculum is created based on what you found in that particular area. So I think these are some of the issues that we think about when understanding what poverty means and understanding how to design a program in a particular context.
Thanks, Jasveen. It's clearly a task in each of our hands to take this into account wherever we want to implement the graduation approach, really understand ultra poverty in its own context, and to be able to contextualize. I go to Shagun. Shagun, the I mean, we hear from multiple people now. We've heard from the Didi herself. So we have the evidence, and you are, as an organization, creating evidence on graduation approach. But it is still, I would say, and I think in conversations with many practitioners, graduation approach is still not commonplace as other interventions are. It is still not very well understood. It is both amongst rural development practitioners, in the government, in the nonprofit circle. So what can we do to make it more commonplace? How do we, in a way, popularize the model so that it gets adopted more? How do you, and the second question is, how do you influence policy, guidelines, etc.? But how do we make graduation approach more commonplace?
Yeah, so thanks, John. I think everyone, you know, today has also touched upon, so far we have really been talking about how powerful this approach is and how it really works. And we've also heard some really inspirational, you know, conversations from Mr. Bala, for example, on why he really thought, as someone who had this charge, who had this, who had to do something to reach out to these people, and how he tried to fit this into the existing state rural livelihood mission infrastructure that currently exists across India. But I think it's also really important to acknowledge that this program is a complex program. It has multiple different, you know, aspects to it. Even the targeting, like I said, that for it to be a true program, you need to go down to the most last mile to be able to identify who these people are. And we've also talked a lot about the importance of scaling this so that it reaches many, many more people. And, you know, all of us, you know, kind of want to have this, want to have this sort of a mandate that ultra poverty should just be eradicated, because at the time at which we are talking today, with there being so much economic development around the world, and yet you have people who are sometimes not able to afford two square meals a day, who have such kind of things that should absolutely not happen anymore to humanity. You're absolutely right. Why is graduation approach not being adopted? I do think that the lesson really lies in saying that even as those who who promote the graduation approach or who really back it up, how much of an effort are we making to try and marry it with what is already existing, right? And if you think about it from the government systems, it's not easy to scale. It's not easy to build systems. You need to have certain things in place, and governments also cannot. I know every time we say, okay, it's a one-size-fit approach, we should contextualize. But from a government lens, it is very, very difficult to contextualize, because we don't, especially in low and middle income countries, where you don't have very nimble and fast systems that can adapt, you know. So I would really say that what has worked, for example, in Bihar, like Mr. Bala also said, that when the government had invested in the National Rural Livelihoods Mission, it is essentially a loan-based model. It is about people coming together. It is about group loans. But this particular group is not even able to save your 20 rupees a week type of target. And so they are not able to take advantage. And now when moving to a graduation approach, you're essentially moving to a grant-based model, where you're giving them an asset, you're giving them something, and you're not expecting. So it is really a lot of, you do need to do a lot of homework to be able to build this. And I would say my message to all of us here who are really trying to push this program is that we also have to meet the governments halfway. It's not easy to just say, go and replicate this, you know, and just put it in your system. We have to also find them ways. What are the budget line items? What is the existing manpower? In Bihar, they did launch a separate frontline health worker called the master resource persons, who were able to take it up. So there is a lot of investment that goes in. And I think that it is really, and also when we, one thing we've not touched upon is that we've talked about evidence. We've not talked about that when you're implementing a program like that, the importance of data being generated, the learnings that are being generated on the go, how important that is. And again, we've been very fortunate in Bihar, where there is so much of this openness to saying, tell us what's happening, tell us what we can course correct, tell us how the data can influence our decisions while the program is being implemented. So I would just say that it's a combination of all of this. And I know I have less time, so I'll hand it back to you.
No, thank you, Shagun. Thank you so much for sharing those. It's all up to us as practitioners as well to promote the model. Bala sir, I come to you last. Roshni tells me we have another 5 minutes. What I really want to hear from you, sir, is you brought some of the best in class organizations to Bihar to make SJY a reality. JPAL, World Bank, Co-Impact, Bandhan, and others. But that also means collaboration, each one having their own points of views, very different cultures, very different organizations. How do you bring a multiple organizations together and run a single program in a multi-stakeholder approach? What does it take for a state to anchor this?
Before answering this question, I missed the second part of the first question about convergence. Now again, to take what Shagun mentioned, it's not easy to fit in these kind of programs immediately. Even in Jivika, what we understood, we need to create a separate structure. Again, we have convergence, but convergence can come in only if those families are going to move one particular level. Otherwise, whatever convergence you do, you open the account, you again make them as part of SHG, again, that's not going to work. So that's the reason this SGOI program started. We had a separate PMU, separate team, dedicated team, and then they're working with Didis, and then convergence comes in. Some of the things happens parallelly, for example, opening up of account, FIT. Again, that's the reason Jivika like program, SRLM is a beautiful, brilliant platform where all these convergence aspects can be taken care of, including, they are part of SHG, they are getting their insurance done, and then they started saving. And then you have, livelihood programs within Jivika, farming, livestock. They are given with, some of them are taking goats, and then you are having a Pasu Shakti program which is helping them. So again, within Jivika ecosystem, you have all these aspects. And then you are working with government, and then you are ensuring the social protection benefits are reaching them, housing program, drinking water connection, sanitation, electricity connection, you are able to. And that's how it is happening as far as convergence is concerned. I guess a beautiful platform as far as the SRLM is concerned. Again, coming back to the second question, it's common for any program, if you are going to involve multi stakeholders, you need to have these things in common. You need to acknowledge the core competence of the different organizations. You need to admit and then acknowledge. And then common objective. When you are having clarity, this is the objective of this program, all these partners are agreeing to it, and then of the battle is won. Third, you need to have the ability to listen, and then, some of the grievances are arises, and then ability to address those grievances. And then you need to have a strong communication channel to reach out to, and then to talk to, and then willingness to hear, and then your own shortcomings, and then ability to take course correction. These are all the, not only for this program, whenever you are going to have multi-stakeholders, you need to have this. Otherwise, it's impossible to take all the partners along and then have a very smooth unit. That's how we are trying to do. And then, of course, at the end of the day, you need to be very honest in your dealings and transparent in your working. If these things are, going to be there, we are fortunate to have those partners, JPAL, Bandhan, Coimpact. When I say Bandhan, Konahar, and then we have World Bank supporting us in between. So our team is good. So that's the reason when we are having all these ingredients, so we could able to stitch this team, and I'm confident that we'll succeed in this endeavor. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for everyone for your time. I don't think we have time for Q&A at this point. Thank you so much to all the panelists. Didi, Johar, bahut bahut dhanyawad. Join karne ke liye. And namaste didi. Okay, thank you sir, thank you everyone for joining us. It was a wonderful session, so much to take out and so much to follow up on.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks John.